Well, good afternoon. Good afternoon to everybody, and welcome to our masterclass, our LUIS Alumni Masterclass. I'm extremely pleased to resume our discussion in and around relevant themes, but also with a different and new configuration. As each of us knows, we started off our LUIS Masterclass series in April during lockdown. And we did have the opportunity to discuss a number of themes with colleagues and representatives from corporations, from the public administration, from also from other countries. And we did gain a lot of insights on what we used to call the new normal. We've decided, therefore, to resume our discussion and using the same format. And therefore, we kept our label of brand, actually, of LUIS Masterclass, and decided to extend these interesting initiatives also to our community of alumni, who are pretty much diffused all around the world. And again, the idea was to involve our alumni network to, again, discuss with different perspectives, from different perspectives, on key issues. And so I'm particularly pleased to have decided to launch these initiatives. And particularly, I'm pleased today to introduce to you our two guests, Cristina Diofebbo, who is a Senior Director of Strategic Insights and Analytics, Pricing and Operation at Sky, and Marco Ficarelli, Executive Vice President for Asia Pacific at Coty. So it's a great opportunity to have these two distinguished alumni from our network to discuss with us again on a very interesting topic. The discussion will be led by Michele Costabile, who I'm also thankful to him for his leadership of the discussion today. Also would like to say hello to Andrea Battista, who is the president of the LUIS alumni community and has been an important role to organize this masterclass. Well, as we usually say, without further ado, I will leave the floor to Michele Costabile, and then of course thanks again to Cristina and to Marco for their time, also their insight and perspective on today's topic. I'm not sure whether Andrea would like to say something or will intervene later on or during the discussion. But in any case, I'll leave the floor to Michele first, and then he'll decide on how to involve our speakers. Thanks again, and I'm sure we'll learn a lot today. See you in a minute.
Thank you, Andrea, and thank you to our guests. My task today is just to launch the discussion about a very wide topic, but that I'm sure we will have the opportunity to focus on some specific elements, thanks to the extraordinary experience that our guests are able to share with us on their domain of activity, that is both, as you can see, a specific geography and both a specific field and so point of view. The idea is to talk about the COVID aftermath, and so the consequences that we are all experiencing about the pandemic effect we suffered since last February, at least, and in some geography since last January. So let me start in a few minutes. Just sharing with you some ideas about what we saw, what we discussed on a surface of the COVID-19 effects and what is really happening as an effect in some way driven by the pandemic. We saw and we talked and we discussed on a lot of issues that at the end of the story, I think are becoming now more rhetorics than realities. So we discussed about how the pandemic could improve our way to behave, our way to consume, our way to work. We talked a lot, at least in Italy, in some other European countries of the Southern and Central Europe, about smart working, even if the experience was mainly on remote working, and how we should rethink and redesign market economy and the capitalist as a way to do business. There was a lot of discussion on the consumer side and corporate side on the resilience, what should be the attitudes towards the future, and the resilience being the main resource we should leverage on in order to go through the pandemic more hot first wave, we can say now, because of the second wave, at least in some European countries, going on, unfortunately, and what we should think will be a permanent change. So we have a lot of talk about the new normality or the next normality. And so we were all engaged on the idea that everything could be changed, everything could be different. But at the end of the story, the ideas now emerging is that there is nothing really or radically new, but what is happening is that, as Mr. Harari well explained on Financial Times last March, that at the end of the story, what's happening is a fast-forward dynamic, that many phenomena already evident before pandemic are now becoming more evident or even a priority or even the huge phenomenon to deal with. So the idea is that, as was effectively explained by Mr. Harari, the short-term emergency measures and, let me say, phenomena will become something common in the next landscape, and is becoming something that we have to go very fast forward on. So the idea now is to discuss with our prestigious guests about what they think is really going fast forward. 3-4 different ideas were emerging from my personal analysis on what marketeers or businessmen in general, executives are talking on. One is about the purpose. We talked a lot before pandemic about purpose branding. Now, all the company, all the C-suite level executives are talking about a purposeful business mindset, not only about purpose branding. Before the pandemic, we talk about omnichannel options that some companies were just, you know, testing on different geographies with different combination of channels, being at the core of this omni-channel strategy, distribution strategies. Now we are going fast forward the omni-channel structures everywhere, and even further towards an evolutionary distribution format testing. We talked about the market economy redesign or, you know, reform. Now it's quite clear that we have definitely to redesign a consumer side economics. We have to completely redesign the rules and the way we trade and we do business, considering that both at micro and at a macro level, everybody's considering behaviors, economic behaviors in general and consumer behaviors, first of all. We talked about data privacy concern, but now we are fully aware we cannot avoid to share data and personal data. And so we have just to design the better way to create value in a reciprocal perspective in data sharing. We used to say that we're industry-specific business evolving into convergence, into hybrid. Now it's quite clear that there will be a market fluid company era in the future with hybrid convergence, hybrid products and hybrid competition to deal with. And last but not least, we used to work about technology, artificial intelligence, consumer artificial intelligence, augmented reality or virtual reality, considering how the technology can be managed in the marketing perspective. Now we have the growing awareness and a growing we are very sensible now about the concept of augmented humanity. So the idea that the tech, all the technologies, has to be part of an human experience. And so the concept of augmented humanity, so of the blend of technology and conventional market experience, has to be designed and further enhanced. So that's all what I want to say in order to introduce the debate, asking to our guest what you think about these or even other issues that because of the pandemic are becoming relevant or prominent in your perspective. And I would like to start with Cristina Diofebo. What is your opinion of some of these issues on other issue that you consider now prominent because of the pandemic? Thank you, Cristina. Sorry, maybe there is another.
Thank you, Michele. Thank you. So I think it would be useful to follow the order of your topics, the one you just presented. So I think if we start, for instance, from your concept of, you know, how the purpose branding is shifting to a purposeful business mindset, I think this is a very interesting and pertinent topic for our discussion. I'll give you the experience I have from the UK and from the media sector, obviously. But it's definitely in UK we talk about entering the era of the public. where we think consumers will expect brands to assume more responsibility for building a better society. This trend was already there, but definitely has been accelerated significantly by the pandemic. So what does it mean, for example, for media companies? It means that we need to manage the corporate, the CSR, the corporate social responsibility efforts in a much more focused way. That will help us build, an authentic brand strength. We already started the process. We already were heavily involved in anything in the big topic as sustainability, as helping the community, helping the employees and the staff, which are the big themes that are coming out from our consumers' research, being at the center of expectation from consumers from the big brands. Marketeers will need to be able to communicate very clearly the cause or causes we stand up for, and where we want to make a real difference. And that will, basically be, it will be critical also to convey these messages with the right honesty, empathy, and social consciousness in order to really deliver an authentic message to our consumers. So where we are focusing at the moment here in the UK, not just my company, but many companies, is to strike really the right tone in the advertising and just moving from price and offers messages to a much more value, emotional connection type of messages. So that's some thoughts from your first topic. Maybe I will hand over to my colleague to, listen to his views on this topic.
Thank you, Cristina, and thank you, Andrea and Michele, for this opportunity to talk together about interesting topics. Important probably to say that I'm not based in Europe, but I'm based in Asia, currently in Singapore, where in a part of the world where the pandemic started. And many things and many trends came here, and probably many things we are also quite advanced in how to face this, the concern related to the current new norms. Because what I found very interesting in the discussion and the introduction that Michele shared with us is as the evolution of this new way of doing is becoming a new norm. And when we talk about how the brands and how the company and how the society is acting in this new context, we need to frame it taking into account multiple factors. And this is also related to the points that Cristina was highlighting before. When I talk about multiple factors, we need to consider the geography, the culture, the religions, the way of thinking. Indeed, the brands are becoming more and more important. But what is more important for me is that today is, if before, while we were doing marketing or we were talking about business, we were putting the brand in the middle. And so our conversation was brand-centric. In my point of view, we are more and more going to a more consumer-centric. And this is because we are understanding that life is unpredictable. Many things that we thought we could control are not controllable. In the first phase of the pandemic, we focused on the things that we could control. Now we are realizing that even if we can control things, not everything can be controllable, and therefore there is the emotion of the consumer in the middle. In one end, we have to talk about social responsibilities. In one end, we have to talk about clean business. And when we talk about, in my context, for example, I work in the beauty industry, we talk about clean beauty. But at the end, what we talk and what is the most important is to talk to the consumer. In fact, we are going more and more from brand-centric to a consumer-centric. And this is also, I would take the opportunity to also link to the second point of the discussion and of the presentation that Michele showed us before, in when we're talking about from omni-channel option to new structure. In my point of view, and in the way we are seeing today also in this side, in Asia, is we are moving from a concept of omni-channel to a concept where the consumer are going. We have to be where the consumer are shopping. We were before, but before we were not close to the issue that today consumer has to react with our, has to act and react to our products in a different way, because probably they cannot touch the products that they are going to buy. They cannot experience before buying that products. And therefore we need to create a new way of interaction to the consumer. We are creating multiple way of interacting with the consumer. In our industry, we are talking about new technologies, but definitely I think that Cristina, in her industry or in the media world, there are also other points. I don't know if you want to add more on this topic.
Because we were highly...
Yes. Sorry, go ahead, Cristina. Thank you very much, Marco. Yeah. Cristina, it's very interesting your experience, both considering the industry and the market, then considering the geography. And after that, we have a question coming on the chat that I would share with you. So go on, Cristina, and then yeah. I will give you
the obviously, the media industry is at the forefront of technology. So we've been advancing quite quickly over the last 5-10 years. But I think all of this pandemic has even accelerated our media industry. You know, I think we talk about what happened in the last 5 months could have taken 10 years. So the exposure to, you know, digital content and, you know, television content from a very high elevated numbers of consumers has accelerated massively. But I was telling Marco before the call that this poses some, competition challenges for us. You know, the expectation from consumers has also accelerated. They want to have easiness in their interaction with digital technologies. They want to have always the top content ready for them at the right time, on the right interface. They want to get to know your content on the go, across a lot of different channels. So it poses this acceleration of digital solution, obviously poses a challenge for all the media companies to really be with the consumers at the right moment, with the right content, the right production, and the right marketing at the right time. So it's definitely definitely accelerated all our digital strategies. As I said, in UK, digital is very, very advanced. It's already a critical channel. It's more how we're going to capture the customer attention now that every customer has been exposed to a lot of content platforms. So for us, it's a matter of really providing that exclusive and easy experience for customers. It's going to be our next challenge from a media perspective. I think you're on mute.
Yes, thank you, Cristina. And the first question, I think it's interesting and relevant for both, because we are talking about what is changing, and so let me say the benefit of this change, of this acceleration. But one question that we got from WhatsApp is, what do you think about the risk, or what are the biggest risks you are running because of this fast forward dynamic in your company,
in
industry?
Yeah, yes. So I think I wouldn't define it as a risk, more as a challenge. For us is to really provide the perfect customer journey, the perfect touch point interaction, and understanding how new channels will complement each other in a synergistic ecosystem of channels. So for us, that's I would say for our industry, for my company, for other companies in the media industry, is really the challenge of getting the journey right, getting to the consumer in the most effective and efficient way. So that's more of a challenge. Is becoming even very, very competitive. We have a lot of competition from a lot of different platforms. So it's a competition that provides improvement in the industry and provides a push for innovation, which is great. I think it's a great challenge that all of us in the industry has, and ultimately the winner is going to be the consumers getting access to even better technologies, to even better content. So it's a challenge that will result in a consumer-centric output from a media perspective.
To add some points on this, I mean, of course, digital solution can be perceived like a monster, when we talk about human touching and human relation. In Asia, there is already a quite solid history about this digital solution. I mean, of course, we have we talk with our consumer in multiple different ways. Today in China, if you don't have WeChat, you are nobody. In Korea, if you don't use KakaoTalk to give a gift to your friends, you are disconnected. So the digitalization is increasing in an exponential way. What is important is that the digitalization today is, in our industry, helping to be in touch with our consumer. Consumer that, in a way or another, due to the lockdown, we could not reach. In a media industry, you can reach through the media tools. In our industry, where the direct consumer relation and the retail experience is important, you need to reach your consumer in different way. Digitalization help us. Today we have different app or different technology and that are allowing us to reach our consumer. Of course, the human touch is important. But I give you this example to explain how we use these digital assets to still keep the human relation in the consumer journey. For example, our shops, our boutiques has been closed for many months. But anyway, our consumer wanted to have the experience that they have with their shop assistant. That is, a shopping assistant in our industry is a consultant, is a person that take care about your beauty aspect, but also take care about your personality. You talk about your issues in the family. It's a moment that every woman or every man, when enter in a beauty world, want to feel and share his experience. We create a system that is called concierge, where our shop assistant were calling through the apps or the digital platform that we have the consumer, their consumer, assisting them in a digital way, creating a sort of relation and contacts, and also helping them to resupply the products or to give them some assistant or psychological assistant, because we always say that when you don't feel good or you feel depressed, you put a parfum or a lipstick and then you look beautiful. So this kind of relation we intensify. So indeed, digital app can create barriers, but we need to be smart in the way to use those apps. Michele, you are on mute.
Sorry, thank you. Very interesting. Both the way that Cristina used in order to transfer, share the idea of, let me say, holistic redesign of the customer journey in order to tackle to deal with the challenge of digital acceleration and the very specific, let me say, deep and situational example that Marco gave us. So we have to work on both levels, both on a complete redesign of the journey and working on very, very more specific way to create an experience that should have the same, let me say, emotional engagement power, involvement power that conventional distribution channel had. So this is the challenge, to enhance the emotional content of the relationship, whatever is the media used in order to interact. Very interesting. I have two quick questions before to go further on the discussion of the issues we used as a platform for our masterclass. The first is, what is specific to Marco, but maybe we can share the question, is what do you think is the main difference between Europe and Asia regarding, you know, the emotional sphere of the consumer behavior, and so the way of building emotional messages through advertising or through personal interaction or through package or whatever. Also atmosphere, both digital atmosphere and store atmosphere.
Well, I think that in general, consumers are all equal around the world. I had the pleasure to work in almost all the countries in the world, and I can say that consumers follow the same journey everywhere in the world. Of course, there are some different variables that are related to the different consumers. For example, when we talk about emotional advertising, it depends even regarding, I mean, the difference between Asia and Europe. Asia is immense. Whatever is emotional in India is completely different from what is in Japan, and what is in China is completely different than what is in Australia. So it's a very huge territory. What I can say is that in this moment, what is shifting is more from a pure emotional message, the famous Mulino Bianco family, to a very benefit insights explanation. So when we advertise a product today, we have to talk about what are the benefits for a consumer to use this product and why it's better than another. What is the technology behind? So we are stretching from this emotional message to a more benefit-oriented message. And this is a game changer. Why that? Because we are in a moment where, like I said before, we were sure to control whatever was around us, but in reality we are not. And the COVID gave us exactly this sense of weakness around us. And that's why we want to reinforce and strengthen the benefit message in our communication. Then, of course, it depends about the geographies and depends also about categories. I think that in Asia, this is important, very important, especially in China. Today, to sell a product, you have to explain to the consumer and give it clearly what it does and why you need to use it. Otherwise, they will not buy. There will be other products to buy. So the market is becoming more and more competitive in this direction. I think it would be stretched very similar also what is happening in the media industry with Christina, right?
Yeah, it's very similar. Actually, I was nodding because I think the theme is very relevant for us as well, that shift to explaining the benefit that the product provides in the consumer life is a key theme for us, and the key transition from a very transactional marketing message to a much more value message. So consumers need to understand what they are you know, how the product is enhancing their life, essentially, which for us is obviously we bring consumer closer to the content that they love, therefore their life is going to be better and easier. So this type of messages explaining the benefit absolutely resonate also in the media industry. So two very different industries, two very different geographies, but still very similar journey, I guess, post the pandemic.
We try to focus now on a different, you know, let me say, very relevant topic. Do you think that the pandemic has changed, as somebody is saying, the way we approach the data privacy concern? So we are less worried, more worried. We consider our personal data sharing something unavoidable. Or is changing something in your opinion? Also in the way companies are, you know, giving building trust about the way they process data, they use data. What's your opinion? Because we are forced to give our data now all over Europe, at least, Marco. I exactly don't know what's happening in Asia or in Singapore, but all over Europe, we are in some way forced. If we go to see a theater show, or we some, very often when we go in restaurants, we have to share our table mate name, our phone number. So we have to enable the owner of the restaurant or the owner of the movie house to get the right and timely the right and the timely tracking of what we are, because of the you know, the way to treat people that are suspected to have a contamination. So what do you think this is going to impact to the data privacy concerns or not, and what you are doing?
Okay, so I start on this side of the world. Whatever is happening in Europe started already many years ago in Asia, and was not related to COVID, but is related to everything. I mean, if I talk about my life in Singapore, we have a government app since day one. We register is with our is called FinCode, that is like codice fiscale in Italy, or our identification number. There is our mobile phone number, is all linked with the government. Wherever we check in and check out, in any place we have to do check in and check out. This is helping to trace and to track all of us. Is an issue, of course, if you have something like Singaporeans say, if you have something to hide, of course it's an issue. If you don't have nothing to hide, it's not an issue. So this is the mindset, you know, it's very simple. It's like, I mean, why you have to be worried? You don't have nothing to hide. You can see where you are, anywhere, anytime. As this is happening everywhere. So in my point of view, we need to understand very well the concept of data sharing and what is the importance of sharing our data. Today, the business, because of lack of traffic in stores, especially in our retail industries, is done through CRM. CRM is the sharing of data. Of course, you authorized your data, but without CRM, any industry can survive after COVID. Was fantastic to see, and probably everywhere in Europe were in all the newspaper, because I saw it also in the Italian newspaper, when in April they were shooting picture of China with outside fashion boutique or high brand luxury brand boutique, people queuing. Why the reason of the queue is not because suddenly people decide to shop, it's because the CRM system of that special brand or any brand invited the clients to an event. Today, CRM is crucial. Data sharing is important. Of course, there are limits of everything. Of course, there is a role and is to be regulated. There are some markets, some countries, where this is based on a cultural things that is more free, like in the case of Singapore, that, like I said before, when you ask, when you start to complain about sharing your data, I say, but do you have something to hide? No, so okay, do it. Or there are some more extreme markets, countries, but this is the issue of the data today is very much Western countries, where I still, there is not yet a huge culture of sharing data. In the fact that here everything, you know, in this side of the world, we live without cash. It's all cashless. And from COVID, we are cashless because cash can transfer also the virus according to the studies that we have here. So is everything through app, we pay all with the phone, we use only the phone. And all our apps are putting us in relation with third parties. All the
sorry. So there is Marco. You are experiencing double change. One is about cash from cash to cards. Now from cards to devices.
Yeah,
yeah.
So in China, since 3-4 years, is all phone with WeChat.
Yes.
All the payment are do WeChat. All the transfer of the money, I mean, also in Europe, in Switzerland, I was in Switzerland, is from, you transfer money from telephone to telephone. You don't give any more money by cash,
yeah,
which is a relative tools in this moment. In the COVID time, even more, because can transfer the virus. At least that's what they say. But all the time that you flash your phone, you give your data. So you can do it putting your telephone number when you go to a restaurant, but if you pay with your card, you give your data anyway. Or if you have your telephone on, you are giving your data in that cell where you are in. So it's probably is a cultural shift that Western country has to do more than Eastern one, where this cultural shift already happened.
Thank you. Christina, what about your perspective? Because,
yeah,
of course, there is a matter of pricing and the matter of protection as well. But protection is another side. It's another story. Sorry, Marco. I know. It's just to Christina. Thank you.
I think from data privacy and data protection in the UK, we were quite advanced already, and you know, all this also behavior, you know, cashless behavior, all this behavior that Marco referred to, it's very similar in the UK. So I think UK is a bit different from Southern Europe from that perspective. I think a couple of consideration here in terms of what consumer will expect, in exchange of all this data they're going to share. I think it's important to reflect that consumer will expectation, I think, will change in the sense that, for example, if you take our industry where we collect, data on what customer watch, you know, the expectation is that recommendation are increasingly, will increasingly get better and better because, you know, the moment I have 2 minutes to decide what to watch, I want to have the perfect recommendation of my box, on my mobile, on my devices, different devices. So I think what we're seeing in the UK is that expectation of the consumers to that company use and leverage the data in a much more effective way than before, and actually it's becoming almost a sort of lever for competitive advantage. Who use that data in a very efficient and effective way is going to win the attention of the customer, which ultimately means loyalty and engagement, ultimately means lower retention. So we are working on the data more on that aspect now, because data privacy in UK is quite advanced, and data rules. So we did a lot of work over the last 5 years on that. So now it's more about how do we demonstrate to our customers that the data they are giving us are used in a way that bring them more value from our products. And that's the evolution of the media industry at the moment. So this is where we are in terms of data value for customers. You're on mute, Michele.
Sorry. The challenge now that the moment is the pandemic is creating, let me say, a kind of enabling dynamic in order to push more and more in explaining the value that we can add as a company to our customer base using their data, and so increasing, let me say, the gap between the worry and the fear of a data misuse and the real and tangible value of the data, of the data smart use.
Yeah.
Thank you. Sorry, I have a question now in the middle that is arriving, is arrived by Emanuele, that asked us, is asking you, but if you should just give us in a few words an idea of an if and how marketing strategies and specific initiatives changed over the last few months. If there was some change between the first two or three phases in the pandemic management that in Asia began in January, in Europe more or less end of February, March. There is something that you can for sure say, yes, this is something that is changed. Or not.
If I, yeah, I mean, in our business, in our retail experience business, almost everything changed. Because first, you have to think that in our side of the world, the consumer cannot touch or test the products before buying them. So all these marketing activities that we were doing with the touch point to consumer, shift from a real world to a virtual world. In terms of strategies and communication, so we are talking, like we said before, we are talking more on the benefits on the products because the consumer cannot experience the product, cannot test the product. And this is in all consumer good categories. You cannot touch the products. So this is a very big game change. And then, of course, also the way to communicate is changing. Like we just said before, from emotional value to more benefit behind the product. We were, and now also the communication and the way to do the communication is more targeted, even more than before, because if before we were broadening our audience, when we were targeting our advertising campaigns, now we are really focusing on specific targeting, because only in this way you can reach the sales. We don't have to forget that this, because I mean, we are talking about a lot of nice things, but many businesses suffered because of COVID-19. So also the budget related to the communication and the media strategy changed completely in the last 2-3 months. And that's why we need to be more and more focused in talking directly to the to the consumer and be more and more consumer centric.
Oops. Michele, you're mute.
Sorry, Cristina, what your perspective on that?
Yeah, obviously different experience from the industry, Marco's industry. I was telling Marco before the call, obviously, you know, consumers have been exposed to even more TV than before, but you know, traditional pay TV is a premium product. You know, people needs to pay for the service. It costs money. So for us has been a lot of focus has been put into understanding the economy impact on our, you know, consumer and customer base. So reassessing our customer segments, our internal customer assessing, and reassessing the overall consumer segment. We had to ask ourselves, are our consumer segments and, you know, targets are going to be the same, or do we need to start thinking in a different way because behaviors are going to change? So very, very quickly into the pandemic, I had to do quite a lot of work on reassessing our customer segments because you want to be out there with the right price, the right offers, with the right message. You don't want to send, you know, wrong offers to the wrong customers that have been impacted from economy. So it's for us, it was really understand the economic impact on our base and on consumers, which we think you know is quite important to be able to talk the right language at the right moment with consumers. So that was our experience.
Thank you very much. So the discussion could go on for many times, but as you know, we try to stay within the constraint of 1 hour in order to have a sparkling masterclass. And so thank you, because the sparkling was added by you by your experience. Now I think it's time to ask Andrea Battista to give us a message in closing this masterclass. And let me say thank you very much for your experience shared with us. Andrea, to you the conclusion or the remarks, conclusive remarks.
Thank you very much, Michele. I should have unmuted, so hope you can hear me pretty well. So first of all, thank you, everybody, Christine and Marco, in particular, but obviously also Director Andrea and Michele for this deep and insightful discussion. What I would like to say is only one word on this, then I will give some final remarks on this format and why it is so important for the alumni community and for our association. The only remark I would add to this powerful discussion is that what I observed and learned is that also in this field, there is probably something we could define post-pandemic knowledge, post-pandemic views, post-pandemic approach, or something like this, depending on what we are talking about. We observed that also in very different industries, like the one which were wonderfully represented today, there were common trends together with natural asymmetries considering the difference of the industries. This idea that there is something which is very cross, very horizontal across functions, world, continents, industries, and so on, which comes after the pandemic, is really the core and I would say powerful idea which is behind the format of the masterclass, which was so successful as Andrea at the beginning was underlining during the lockdown period and also across the summer. What I would like to add on this is that this idea, project, and now concrete format that for the first time was on air of putting together distinguished professor of our beloved university and other some selected distinguished alumni is something which is at the core of what we are trying to do in our activity as an alumni association. Putting together, integrating, exchanging values between alumni community and university, and from university to alumni community, creating a two ways exchange of value to the benefit of the whole system of LUIS. The second point is that having represented different continents, today we missed North America, but in principle, our idea is to put together all the world, all the different continents which are facing the same post-pandemic trend and challenges gives us the concrete touch of the internationalization of our alumni community and of our university, and internationalizing the connection of our alumni community, creating chapter, moving across chapters, but in particular through all these digital format and tools is one of the main aim and targets of the activity that we are performing as association. I think that all the features that we designed for this format, internationalization, discussion among alumni and between alumni and the academic LUIS community, a representation of different continents in this arena of the post-pandemic knowledge and challenges have been fully and wonderfully represented and made concrete in this first alumni masterclass. And for this reason, I close thanking everybody, not only our speaker, but also all the alumni which at this time, different time all around the world, have connected to follow this debate, and in particular to all the friends which also asked their question to make our debate even more live and interesting. So thank you everybody, and the word again, the scene again to Michele.
Thank you, bye.
Bye.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.